it can't provide for itself. You know, most people are too inhibited to dress up, make a noise, be energetic and do things. But we do them for them. We're not doing something out of the past. We're not coming out with pagan roots, pre-Christian behaviour. That's a load of cultural. It never was the origin of Morris. But there is something pagan and primitive in everybody. And we're actually helping express that for people. You know, the same way as it's lovely to go watch a carnival and see people dressing up and make idiots of themselves and things like this. You get a great deal of pleasure yourself. We're doing something you wouldn't dream of doing. Right? And I think that's people's attitude to all of us. We're doing something special for them. We're doing special something for the community. Not that the community will pay us for doing it. But in the past, they have, in fact, paid for Morris dancers to perform at functions and so on. I mean, one of the things that have been discovered in recent years about the Lichfield Morris is that it was an integral part of the general elections in Lichfield. In the days when it was a Rom borough, and often there was only one candidate and he automatically won, they still had to have a celebration. They used to chair the winner and carry him around the town, preceded by a band and Morris dancers. Morris dancers would pay a few pounds for doing this every general election. And the more trouble there was in the days when general elections could occur every year in the early 19th century, the more the Morris benefited. In Adderbury, to take another example of it, in Adderbury, it was another rotten borough where nobody had a chance to vote for anybody, let alone have a celebrate. They used to take the town's fool, you know, the picture of the chap wearing the waterboard and gay. He had a disability in the sense that his thighs were longer than his lower legs. His knees were a bit lower down than normal. And he had problems of getting around. When he was a fly carrot, he wasn't stupid. He exploited this enormously over the years. And they used to put him up as the rival candidate for the elections. And of course, he never got any votes because he wasn't actually able to stand. But they'd still, around Banbury, have a celebratory procession to carry him around on an armchair, on a couple of poles and so on, and have a great do. And Morris was involved, and so on and so on. You know, these mock mayors and businesses of this sort now have a very strong tradition. It's something, in my opinion, we ought to revise, particularly if we don't like the local candidates. But still, you know, it has a sort of role. In fact, perhaps the thing to say about the Morris, to round it up, is that it was the intention at the turn of the century that the Morris should be given back to the people. They didn't understand what it meant, but they set off with the best of intentions. The FDSS was founded. Despite all the internal politics and all the things that were wrong, as it were, what was essentially an upper middle class activity for many years, the fact is, it has got back to people. But people like you and I who do it come from what would have been considered 100 years or 150 years ago, an ordinary background. But having given it back to individuals to dance, we still haven't given Morris back to the community at large. One of the things I would plead for the future for all the younger dancers to think of is how do we actually get the Morris to be part of the communities to which we belong. If you go to Padstow, Coombe Martin, Baycup, Great Wishford, places of this sort where the dance, I won't claim Morris, the dance is part of the annual custom for time immemorial, it would not be the same, as it were, if there wasn't the dance. It's all part of the scene and part of it. It's possible to revive things. This is how Coombe Martin have got going. They've got a dance procession, a hobby horse, they've got the Earl of Roan and a dozen grenadiers, 40 drums and things like this, and they close the village off for a whole weekend. It's an absolutely incredible experience to get involved in. But these are the things that used to happen in England. These community-wide things. To do it means a commitment, not of the old year, old let's try, old didn't work very well. It's sort of, we're going to do this and we're going to keep at it and keep at it forever. If you go to Burford and the Cotswolds on Midsummer's Eve, that's St John the Baptist Day, you'll see the Burford Dragon. The Now, the birth of dragon is actually a long worm. There's 100 children, that's 100 pairs of legs, in one huge millipede, if you will, centipede, with a head, like, not like a Chinese dragon really, but you know, long costume, and just winds its way around the Thames, the admiring glances of all mums, dads, brothers, sisters, uncles, aunts, granddads, and so on. And the Thames loves it. And all the Morris does is turn up each year saying, "Are we ready for the dragon this year?" And they get it, "I suppose we must," you know, and here it comes and so on, and they keep thinking. They're not the centrepiece, they're the bit that provides, as it were, the motivation to keep going. So I do ask that people should look for whatever was or could be in their area. Yeah, the great thing about customs is that they can appear and disappear overnight. In this day and age, they can appear. Look for what your area did. Did you have a St. Blaise, you know, Bishop Blaise in his procession? Did you actually have riding a hobby horse on a pole? You know, anything, as it were, which you may like to do, which could involve community. You could get some other idiot in the community, like a school, club or other, to actually do all the hard work for it and so on, so that it becomes part of the Woody Shire. Otherwise the Morris will just be a series of little dance troupes, all amusing yourself. With the question really, are we anything other than just a practice club who occasionally go out and are embarrassed when we meet an audience? But you know what I mean. Yeah. I'm all for Morris for the world. I believe that it belongs to people that belong to our community, and that's where it ought to be in future. The handicap of doing it that way is when you talk to the people who do Coombe Martin, you say to them, "Well, here's the Morris." You said, "Well, when we've done Padstone, Coombe Martin, the rest of the year is so flat that we do other things in our life." And that's probably the only problem about it. These can become incredible high spots in your life. Get involved with your thing, doing your bit. But really, that's what we're doing it for you. That's a tremendous lift, a solemn get out of doing something which is more respect. Where I come from, we have village mothers. Been going since 1880, they stole the play from somewhere else, and so on. They've gone on and off over the years. I've been involved with them for 30 odd years. There's a tremendous thing to learn from it that we get young people to do. They join when they're 18 and they're able to drink, and they give up when they're seriously courting or married. There's a little narrow slot in their life where it's right to be a mother, and a tradition. So that's one of the other things you've got to remember about the tradition. It isn't actually for all people. It actually is something for, you know, the people it was designed for in the first place. And perhaps I always end up by reminding those people from the Northwest that, in fact, the dancers that come from children could well go back to children as well. You know, there is a role for children in the world. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Roy. I know of old that he didn't have a chance, Roy will talk till midnight, so the pizzas have arrived. A pizza order, he's going to. If you're going now, please fill a form in. They do get read by me. They normally get passed on.
That's right.
Involved.
And I have felt very embarrassed in the past by your mother. Don't worry, mate.
See you again, yes, I'm sure.
That sort. Well, what do we actually know about them and what brought them on? Well, then I introduced you to Badby, a tradition that my own side big ladies do in the way they do it. You know, one from here, one from there, and things like this. In other words, give it a clean sheet and they're just attracting dancers in. You look for the good dancers. Good for them, not necessarily good for you, no, that's not them. What I'm going to do this evening to start with, the intellectual part I'm using anyhow, is to actually teach some dancers which aren't part of the English tradition at all. Right? They come from the Basque country, they are the equivalent, their equivalent of Morris, they are very typical of the dances that are done in Portugal, Spain, and southern France. And I want you to meet them because you realise that the English tradition of Consul Morris and the continental so-called Morrises really have little in common other than the basic motivation for doing it. That's not to say the dances aren't fun and they're full of ideas that can be stolen, particularly if you're a board aside or anything else, you know, there are some good moves in this lot. So what I'm giving you at the moment, I think, is here's the quarry, here's the rock face, get out your pick, find what you like with this one. Right? Now this first dance was actually got from a woman's side. Now I have to explain one or two things about the Basques. The Basques have been where they are for a very long time. 2,000 to 3,000 years, the Romans bring them there, anyhow. They've always been on that corner of Europe where people pass by. And it's their boast that nobody's passed while they're leading a dance or two. No, they don't claim indigenous dancers, they just claim to have actually picked them up from people passing by. If you remember from history that the kings of England owned Aquitaine, you know, the bit that included for a while the Basque country, from about 1100 to 1460 something or other, a very key period of history where the reconquest of Spain started, you know, kicking the Moors out of Toledo and things like this, and the suddenly discovery of the ancient sciences of the ancients and things like that, tremendous, that it all passed through this particular corner. It's not to say that the Moorish or Morris, you know, had anything to do with Toledo and Spain, but you know, it's quite an important part of it. The Basques, each village had its own family of dancers. Each dance was owned by a particular bit of the community, like the coal merchants, the butchers, the bakers, and things like this. And on their saint's day, a group, their local group, would dress up and go out and tour around the village doing their thing. And their thing varied, the dance they did and the customs that went with it varied from place to place, of course it did, just like it did in England. Except it was a community, it was a little community based, and they only had their one sort of thing. But some were dressed as soldiers, some as devils with black faces and things of that sort, and they had a different sort of character. And if you see the Basques at festivals, they're only doing examples of the dances that come from their area. Now, unfortunately for the Basques, they chose the wrong side in the Civil War in 1937, and the winner dispersed them all over the world. Many thousands went to the United States, and in the far states, in Nevada in particular, the very strong Basque communities, I should say, with a university in Nevada specialised in Basque studies, where they collect the dancers there, and there are teams doing their dances over there. But on the whole, they were spread around Spain. The people who have done a serious collecting for the Basque Museum have identified 700 traditional dances known to have been done, of which they've recovered 400. When they say recovered dance, that's the dance and its costume and all what goes with it. They don't actually perform a dance which doesn't fit. You know, they don't actually know all about it. They're very, very fortunate. But the other thing, up to 1937, it was a male-only tradition. Men, they were the worst sort of chauvinists around, right? But when the save their culture, was in fact the mothers, the women. And they decided to share their dances between the men and the women. And there was a conscious effort to do two things. One was to say there's a standard set of dances that all bars learn. And it's quite true. If you see a sign at the festival, you'll probably say, I've seen a dance like that before. That's probably the set of dances from San Sebastian that they would do. You know? They also do their own local dance in the village. And once you make it know that you've seen the standard dance, what are they doing in their own, they will then often switch over to doing their own sort of dances. The women have got handkerchief dances, stick dances, garland dances, just the same way as the men. As far as I can tell, there's been a fair sharing of the material around. They don't do each other's dances. That's the interesting thing about them. But they have also created some social dances, which we've done before. They had the fandango, you know, the typical Spanish style country dances, but they've created long ways country dances for themselves. But of course, they do it all the other way around. Well, the people, you know, like if you swing, they're swinging the other way, you know. They all pass left shoulders, or you pass right shoulders, and things like that, sort of, you know, just to be bloody mind different, which is another characteristic of the dance. You've only got to see their flag to realise they don't understand how the Union Jack's put together. So it's a fantastic tradition. It requires more skill to do the stepping than is usual for the Cotswold Morris. It's had a long tradition of the ballet, or influence on the ballet, which is why Pas de Bar, Pas de Basque, you know, and so on, as influence. And there were one or two famous dancing masters in the court of the French king came from the Basque country, and they've had a feedback influence on the standard of dance done in the villages. And today, most of the village troops I've heard of actually practice in a dance studio with a bar and mirrors and things of that sort. Now, they take it terribly seriously and they reach a very high standard. And if you've seen their ability, that's right, they kick, right? They get the toes up above head level, men and women and so on. That requires starting very young to be able to do. And we're not going to do any of that tonight. First of all, I've tried not being before and it ain't possible. And secondly, I don't think we're in a fit state for that. But we are in a fit state to learn some stick dances and so on, right? Now the stick tapping. These sticks are too long. Turning over, under, and then back, front, back. Right, try that. What gets you in the last star behind the front partner? But this slick tapping, variants on the shepherd's toes, is very, very common in the Basque country. Clearly, for the same motivation as their own. Now, I am not going to play the Basque tunes because, quite honestly, the recordings I have are fighting tamers, the Spanish, the Basque whistle is a three-hole pipe. Tuned differently from the English one, and they play very high in the register, and with my hearing I can't make it on the notes are at all. So I shall have to play good old English tunes while you do it. Right, so I'm going to play Shepherd's Hand. Thank you. turned with a clash the long way, as it were, and now we'll repeat that with our neighbour, the clashing with the neighbour. Which way is that? Clockwise, clockwise, right? either it's your opposite if it's going to be your opposite. And which it is depends on where you are on the dance. So are you back to where you started?
No.
Go to where you started and we have to see how far we get on with this. Go to see go all the way around and set back to where you start. Passing left shoulder. Pass with your neighbour, passing left shoulder. Pass with your opposite, left shoulder. And now this is where the fun and games come. You face the other way and you face the other way. Right. We're now going to change ends, left shoulder, with this pair changing with that pair. So just walk past. No, just pass, so you don't, no weaving. One more. Right, face across, cross over. Neighbour, cross over. Then a double shift down the side again. Sense of amazed.
Yeah. Thank you.
you get one hit with one and one hit with the other. If you're the bottom end, if you're the end, you don't get a chance to hit two people who haven't enough music. Right. Your problem is getting there at all.
Your problem is getting there at all. Yeah. Right.
Yes.
Right. So we know when we get that last as we disappear.
Don't struggle to get the hits in. If they come naturally, do them. But as rather you've got there, then waste time.
Right.
We are named Triumphs of Music, as you all are great understanding people and know exactly what you're doing. The problem is actually doing it. Sound out, Steve. Right, are we ready? Nice and slowly. Thank you. was the other bit? Right, so let's try and agree. Great release that we actually could give that one, wasn't it?
Right,
wait a second.
I'll remember the second time.
Thank you.
into northern Italy, things they called the Morris. I have a book of Provençal dances, which includes a Morris that looked like Callihan, large numbers doing simple things. Another one that looked remarkably like the Upton Seven Handkerchief dance, with haze in all possible directions and so on. And of course, these slip dances. One of our local Morrises, Kennet, get involved with Twin Towns for Newbury. Now, Kennet is actually in Reading, it doesn't really matter. They have a twin town in the Rhone Valley who have a women's dance troupe who do the local dances. And they have a suite of eight local dancers. Now, they're local in the sense that the set of stepping, each figure has its own set of steps, is the same from dance to dance. It's rather like Morris jigs, where the foot up and the capers are the same, but the chorus is different. Right? Now they have that, they have the stepping, and of course it's with different implements. It's the same dance, but you can do it with a flag, you can do it with a long stick, you can do it with a short stick, you can do it with a hoop, you can do it with a garland with spikes on you. You just change the implement. And then it has a slight effect on the dance. And the Basques were the same. They have a suite of dancers. There's basically a seven-dance suite that they had, certainly on the Spanish side there. The first figure comes into the ordeal den and they wave the flag over them. They all do that anyhow. That's a convenient way of filling up 5 minutes abroad. And then they have a figure which they do with two sticks, with one stick, with a sword and buckle, and so on, but it's basically the same pattern, it's the same dance. But obviously, depending on what you've got in your hand, depends on what you do. We haven't got swords or buckles, we haven't got garlands, but we do have a long stick. And the long stick we're actually going to do. Right. Now, the problem with this is that it changes direction. So will this set move down a bit? Or will this set move up a bit? Basically, working in fours, you're going to hit your partner high, and then partner again, your neighbour, and your partner. Then you hit your partner, your diagonal, up. Now, this is where the problem starts, you see. The first bit, we're actually hitting standing where we are, right? So we go partner, partner, neighbour, partner. Now, we can tart it up a bit by making these forehands, backhands, underhands and so on. But for the moment, we're actually just going to be hitting hard, right? Partner, partner, neighbour, partner. Now, forget the sticks. Everybody is going to pass their partner by the left shoulder, right, swinging round to end up there. You hit the end, say it at the end. Ending up like that. Right. Back to where you were. You pass the one you're facing with the left shoulder, which means you're not supposed to go, and you swing in. Right. Now go back to where you were, and you'll understand now. When I say, as you do that, you hit your partner to start. Your diagonal, which is the one who's passed, the one who's passing you, the other one, as it were, should be that one. Right? Then your neighbour, having passed, the one you were dancing next to before, and then your opposite, who's just arrived to meet you. Back to where you were, I have one very confused set here in the three. No. never died. Fairly slowly, right? This speed, no, it's right. Are we ready? What's this? the corners, stand like that. The inner ones do what we've just been doing, but they just behave like they're the four of them, right? Well, what have you just been doing? The problem is, doing it with them. You're now change side, you see. In other words, you've now got to do what she was doing, because she was him. He has to do what she was doing, right, because they're facing you. Right? So you now change this. These have a rest. They got their sword just pointing at you while you do it, right? So off we go. That's right, you just pass, jump, bump, hit. That's right, you get two hits. One, two. Because your neighbour, you've got a problem with your neighbour. Translate what you've been doing and say that you have to do what they've done and you have to do what they've done. So just thank you.
big wall.
And that's what makes
it. It's full of every shade, of every colour, and every little. Oh, you go in, you go.
One, two, First time it's just the one, so you get 7 of them and a bag, and then 6 of them and a lesser bag. Most people have a bit of difficulty to start with heel and toe. Face up. the Sherborne one. Now, Howden and the others differ. Well, we'll do Bleddington now. In Bleddington, it's essentially the same. Same sort of figures. Except, of course, you face up and Dave and the foot up and so on. Half jip, whole jip, rounds are the same pattern as Bleddington we did earlier. So that shouldn't represent a problem. The difference is we don't actually have this up and down arm movement. You know, you dance with your hands at your sides. No handkerchiefs, just dance with the hands at the sides.
Right?
So just tuck them away. That's right. It's just a no handkerchief dance. Now, at Bleddington, it was called General Monk's March, and I'll explain after this dance why that's a load of rubbish. Right. Otherwise, it's basically the same stepping, perhaps a bit higher spring if you were doing it somewhere else. Thank you. field 10 steps, right? It's basically 1, 2, 3 with an extra tap. And you're tapping while you're changing weight. Young bunty day. Right. Now the other field 10 step is basically the other way round. It starts with the 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Yum dum dee day, yum dum dee day, yum dum dee day, yum dum. It's rather like a sidestep down the heel rather than the toe. Yum dum dee, yum dum dee day, yum dum dee day, yum dum. But if you think of it like that, then in fact you can get it flowing. It's like a sidestep with the heel. You'll find it in the book. Heel, toe, heel, toe. Right? So heel, toe, heel, toe, heel, toe, heel. And so on. You just flow around, right? With the extra. Now, as far as I can gather, in the heel and toe dancers, the individuals did the best they could do. Right? Which meant if it was they did that. And if it actually they did that. Right? You make the most of showing off. Now, at Longborough, they did it to other tunes. They danced and we won't go home till morning. We won't da diddle da dee da dee dum ba diddle da dee da. Oh hey, I'm bunty, I'm bunty, I'm bunty da dee, I'm bunty. Oh, Susanna, right? Now, there is a difference in doing the dance to the other rhythms of the other sort of tune. Not a great difference, I might say, but there is a difference. And it does suggest, you know, that they got locked into this one tune. Now, as I have to tell you about the tune, but it'll take a few minutes to explain, so I'm going to sit there. I want to sit there. One of the fascinating things, you see, about trying to find out about the Morris is the tales that it leads you into. You see, our first I knew was that Beddington was at Monk's March. And there was a well-known old tune called the Mad Monks of Bangor. You see, and I thought it was that. Seemed suitable from the way we did it. Then we realised that at Leadington itself was actually called General Monk's March. M-O-N-C-K, you know, there's an extra bit in it. And he was the Duke of Albemarle eventually. Now, that led me to look up something about General Monk. Now, you may not appreciate that General Monk wasn't quite sure whose side he was in the Civil War and was arrested for a while until he promised to be a good lad and fight for Parliament. And after they won the first and as it were the second round of the battle, it obviously was not going terribly well. So when Richard Cromwell, Tumbledown Dick, became the protector, General Monk started organising the restoration. The restoration is terribly important because it was the first known revival of Merry England. You know, when he came back, he said, let there be maypoles, let there be bonfires, let there be Morris dancing, you know, let there be all the things that have given up, forgotten, for good reason. You know, those people were no longer interested in doing them. But, you know, it was, that's all. Well, Monk raised an army at Coldstream. He marched slowly down the country. This is meant to be symbolic in the dance. He marched slowly in the country, taking a month or more to get to London. He arrived in London just in time to cow the people around, you know, the aldermen and so on of London, and to invite King Charles back. And he landed, I think, something like the 1st of May-ish at Dover, and entered London on the 29th of May, which happened to be his birthday. Came forever know his Oak Apple Day, and so on, and the great celebration. Right, for which the General Monk, who had married the daughter of a farrier of in Fleet Street, who was reputed to have been married already, was made the Duke of Albemarle to celebrate it. The Grand Old Duke of York, that's, you know, the James, King James later on, his sailors brought a maypole up the Thames and raised it 3 feet and stored it in St Andrew Undershaft. That's why the church is called Undershaft. It was stored there. And every year, the bottom of it would rot off a bit. And after a number of years, the Morris Memorial Trust was downstairs anyway. After a number of years, the pole got too short. It was sold to Sir Isaac Newton, who took it to use it to support his telescope until it actually died in a fire. But it's a lovely story. Unfortunately, it has absolutely nothing to do with dance, because the tune's actually called Belle Isle March. You know, and why it got called Monk's March, we don't know, other than there was also a Mary Morris tune called Monk's March, which was a different tune. Right? Now, Belle Isle, the tune we all know, which I've been playing, Belle Isle March, is actually a Swiss hymn tune. We have a friend who is specialises in the source of hymns and so on, and it's his opinion that, you know, what was said at the time is true. It's a Swiss hymn tune, acquired during, I think it was the Seven Years' War, the one that had the Battle of Minden in it, and so on. Now, this is the time of the Pitt the Elder. He thought a great way of winning wars was to actually capture little bits, like the island in the Bay of Biscay called Belle Isle. Now, at the time, the Marquis de Belle Isle was actually the French war minister in this war, you see, so he's on the other side. So obviously it was meant to hurt, you know, it was be the equivalent of actually capturing the constituency of one of our MPs who actually mattered, if any of them did. So, but they said that. So they invaded the Belle Isle, they captured the Belle Isle, and of course the Marquis de Belle Isle got upset, and the French got very upset. It was like actually capturing the Isle of Wight. The French said that they were doing capturing the Isle of Wight, but failed, I might say, but not through anything that we did, it's just they made a right mess up of their own arrangements. But they after the war, they thought it would be a great idea to have a celebration in London, and as it was King George, they invented a march past of all the troops. In fact, it was the first function, which is considered the originator of trooping with colour, you know, the first thing. But they invited, to show there was no ill feeling, they invited the French ambassador to actually review the troops with King George. So all the bands, when they marched past, as they marched past the French ambassador, switched to the Belle Isle March, just to rub it in, you see. Now, the Belle Isle March, if you listen to the music played for Troop of the Colour, occasionally you'll still hear it played as a quick march. Not at Morris Street, you know, that sort of speed, but it's still part of the repertoire. They were searching for Belle Isle, you know, I was led up a number of interesting garden paths. One is that in the French Civil War, I don't know, whatever they called the revolution, that's right, yeah, you know, when they kicked everybody out, a lot of the people came and lived in what they called Somertown, which actually where St Pancras Railway Station is, in fact, is the area, Chipton, Camden Town, where Cecil Sharp House is. It became one of the biggest rookeries in London, you know, the biggest organised slums. And as a result of that, it was known as that Belle Isle. You know, and that was sarcastically, I hope, and so on. That was one false lead. Another great false lead was discovering that, in fact, Belle Isle is the name, it's been the name over the years for British warships. And we discovered that in the Napoleonic Wars, we captured a French ship of the line called La Formidable, which is sort of 86, 84 young battleship. And we christened it the Belle Isle, you see. And it went to Trafalgar and got beaten up by the French, you know, and didn't survive. The interesting thing about it is that one of the earlier Dommets, who was born and brought up in Devon, where most of the Dommets of that generation were, he was apprenticed in the Navy as a midshipman and rose over the years to, you know, sort of lieutenant and commander and captain in the West Indies under people like Rodney and so on, which, you know, all the, you know, the famous admirals of that sort of time. And he actually was made the captain of the Belle Isle. But he had a job in London during Trafalgar, so he missed it, which is probably just as well. But he also because, you know, he got promotion on seniority, he was actually the oldest admiral in the 1812 war with America. So he was actually First Lord of the Admiralty. And he signed the order for the English admiral who went and took Congreve rockets in his ships across to America and actually fired rockets at Baltimore. You know, the rockets read there in their national anthem. But they also took rockets with them when they went up the Potomac to invade Washington. And they used rockets to shoot at the Capitol building in the White House as an easy way of setting them on fire. So it actually pleases me in my job that it was a dominant, it was responsible ultimately for the only successful rocket attack on the United States. It's also very pleasing, it's the Brits are the only one who've got away with it as well. And so, well, so that bit I wasn't in either. It all comes back really to this story of the hymn tune. Because at the time of the Seven Years' War, although there was a British army, in fact, they were mostly from Hanover or Brunswick, yeah. And we, the Brits, employed Swiss mercenaries. They were, in fact, from the sort of 15th century onwards, a lot of money was earned by the Swiss by fighting abroad because they were better organized and better disciplined than anybody else. So anybody who wanted a smart army actually had a regiment to a Swiss. And it's believed that's how it actually came into the repertoire. Bearing in mind that the British regiments loved to get the tunes from all over the place anyhow. And before 1880, the sort of Grand March from Aida and things like this were the commonly used tunes. When they reorganized the regiments in 1880, when I say reorganized, they actually gave them painted names. You know, before that, they were all numbered, really. And they said that, you know, the so-and-so regiment become the Leicesters and somebody else become the Cheshire regiment, things of that sort. They were all instructed to find a tune for their quick march with some local association. So many of the county regiments actually looked for folk tunes. And you find that two of the Yorkshire regiments have Jockey to the Fair as a march past. One has a standard 8-bar one, the other one has a rather long one. The Warwickshires actually have a tune called the Warwickshire Lads. Now this is a song tune, and I can just see the bandmaster's attitude. You say, well, I've been told to find a tune that the Warwickshire Lads will do, particularly as it's got a 10-bar B music. So every time they march past with other regiments, you know, other regiments run foul of the fact that their tune was longer. So the next colonel of the Warwickshire said, I'm not having that. I don't want to hear this long beam, you know, long tune again. Bandmaster, write a shorter one. So he did. And they played the shorter one when the colonel's within earshot. And the longer one, when he's gone. And that has now been going on for 110 years. Seemed a reasonable sort of habit to have. Somebody did ask me some years ago, see, but we wanted local things from Morris. The answer was, well, look for something local, you know. What was your regimental march past? You know, what was it? And the question said, hey, do I find it? And that proved to be the difficult thing. I have been many years of trying to get together a selection of tunes because many of the regiments learn their regimental march by ear. It's never written down and therefore never published. I mean, Boos and Hawk publish a lot of army marches, but half the regimental marches, we know what they're called, but they aren't actually written down. So it's one of those things, it's one of the things you either go and listen to your band, or write to the adjutant of the regiment, or to the bandmaster, if they still got a regiment, if you still have one, as it were, or try your local museum and say, hey, I'm interested in what the tunes were, and do the bandmaster. Sometimes you strike gold. I wrote to the Lancashire Fusiliers, and they were one of those with Minden. The six regiments, Minden's one of these great things, the Seven Years' War, you see. What actually happened, it's another one of these great stories, really, is that the British cavalry were one side of a wood, and they were told to advance to charge. And Lord Sackville said, you know, advance, where? He said, go to the wood, you fool, you see. And the chaplain brought the message to him, the lieutenant, you know, it was very cheeky. So he got his cavalry through. And the message to the infantry was, when you hear the drums, charge, you see. And what actually was meant is that when you heard the drums of the cavalry charging, you would follow them, see. Unfortunately, the French struck out their drums, and so the infantry marched across the field. So when Sackville got his cavalry ready to charge, he saw the red line of British troops actually at the other side of the battlefield and the French running off. Because the English had been issued with a new gun which fired fast. So for the first time, infantry had a chance against the cavalry. And because of the nature of Minden, they'd put their infantry on the edge with the artillery and the cavalry in the middle. And as the regiments marched across into this gunfire, which nobody had expected, because it's stupid, the cavalry realised if they didn't do anything, the infantry was going to just march up to them and kill them where they stood. So they charged. So they got killed as they charged forward instead. So they charged six times, and what was left just gave up, and all the rest melted away. So the regiments marched over there with not too many cavalry and arrived at the artillery line, and all the French had gone, you see. So as they came back, they were supposed to pick wild roses, red roses, and stuck them in their hats. And the result of that, on Minden Day, that's August the 1st, the Hampshire Regiment, the Suffolk Regiment, and actually Fusiliers, the Chubbard Scottish Regiment, all celebrated Minden Day with a different thing. I think in the Suffolk Regiment, no, in the National Fusiliers, you're not a member of the regiment until you've eaten a red rose on Minden Day, ate a glass of champagne. You have to eat the red rose. Hampshire's just have a parade, but they still keep it up. And the Suffolks actually, inside the barracks and those ends, actually have a pub called the Minden, which is full of memorabilia of the actual battle and the regiment's part of it. So it's just one of those things that's been kept alive for a long time. Oh, well, it's the Minden. It's the Minden Rose. You know, and the great thing is that the regimental secretary actually sent me a complete set of band parts. So if anybody wants to play the Minden Rose, which is not a very interesting tune, but has 24 brass instruments to play it in, I have a full set of parts. Yes, sorry, I've lost the point of the story, haven't I?
You've only got one brass musician.
You've only got one brass musician, yeah. But I say, you know, you just look locally with a bit of imagination, and it's possible to find local customs, local activity, or something local to hang on to. You know, like this morning I was saying about Catherine of Aragon and Dr. Silhouse and the Spanish lady. It's all pseudo folklore, but so what? You know, of the 10,000 tunes that have been published, you know, folky tunes that you can actually dance to, you have to find one. You know, so you look at all the tunes called whatever your local name is, you know, like in my part of the world, Spithead, Fleet, Christchurch Election, and things of that sort. You notice that because you know the places. You know, it doesn't make a tune any better than any other, but it's that sort of, there's a vague connection. The other way, of course, to be what a lot of people do is say, I've got a good tune, I've got a good title, I'm going to call the tune that. And there's no dishonesty about that, because that's the way the Morris has gone on all the time. If you look through the Morris book, you'll find that the same tune is called different things in different villages. They weren't careless about it, they just didn't care. It was irrelevant, really, in the way, you know, in some villages, they couldn't play the tune, so they played another tune. Everybody knew it was Chunkles, the dance of Chunkles, so they came and called Chunkles. In fact, the musician played a different tune. You know, you've got to allay the fact that that's natural. That the people who did things in the 19th century, although they're as bright as you and I, at the same time, they still didn't have the background. I mean, they weren't aware of music in the way we are. I mean, before the days of railroad, radio, television, music halls and things like this, where did you learn a tune? Other than for somebody playing the pub. You certainly didn't have the opportunity to tap the world's resources. Really why British traditions turned out the way they did, you know. You got together to dance, you did what you could dance together. And you modified it, you changed it, and improved it to suit yourself with regard to the outside world. What you didn't have was a black book. All that was talking about Minden. like standing up? And they have a dance which is my team's show dance, I would say, the way it turns out. It is a little difficult to explain. It's not too bad when you've seen it, right? Now, everybody is going to do, now listen to this, you're going to do an open sidestep left, open sidestep right, and two spring capers, right? Now, the problem is where you do it, right? Don't have any problem mentally about doing this, right? Now, the first sidestep to the left, right? While doing the, oh, I teach you to this, I keep teaching you, right? Let's teach this one. Right? I'm shaking. The first sidestep left, you all sidestep left except for the first corner who change places on their sidestep left. Just no to the side. D. That's right, it's D. Yabuck D. They've got to do, right? And then everybody does a sidestep right. And on the sidestep right, this corner, sidestep right, yum, tum, see. Then everybody at this stage does two spring capers. Whoa!
You can't stop laughing.
I'm taking this at a 9 o'clock pace, right? This pair are going to cross over on theirs. One, two. While everybody else does their two on the spot, turning eight. Round two. Right. Then we do half rounds back to where you started.
What second is this?
Now we almost do that again. We sidestep left, right, but you cross over, passing. Left! He looks older than you. And you do rounds the other way. when you get round to the other side, you still do your two spring capers turning out. So, what is your speed post? Thank you. my idea of Duckington is a young person's dance in the sense of drive and vigour. It works when the club has more than one tradition. You know, you can't have a repertoire which is all fast, energetic dances, because after a while the audience thinks, well, that's Morris, it's just a lot of idiots jumping around. You need contrasting dancers, which is why we find this makes a good climax for a show. It's all flurry, dash around, and it's very tolerant of mistakes, because nobody can spot them. Well, not unless you run into each other or something. No. Will you all get a stick each for a Stanton dance? Sussex
Thank you.
One, two, three, and go. Right, let's do it again. Same figures. Matilda Morris. No, one of the lessons I've had in talking to people who compose dances over the years is that they all say you're lucky if 25% of what you invent is any good, in the sense that it probably is perfectly all right for the occasion in which you use it, but they're usually not worth remembering for a long time. It's just a variation on the other. But the idea of actually taking some standard movements from a dance you already got and putting it to tune, composed or chosen for the occasion, is as old as the Morris. You know, it's just one of those things you have up your sleeve. Now, my side, this last Christmas, we went to do a few engagements dancing in shopping centres for Christmas decorations. So we naturally had a set of dances adjusted to suit carols. Now, there was one problem with the carols. The lengths don't fit Morris music. You know, a Morris dance actually requires 24 bars, three lots of eight. You know, and carols don't normally come that sort of length. And you find yourself being Ducklington-like, doing a chorus and a whole hay, rather than a chorus, half a chorus and half a, and so on. So it does require a small bit of ingenuity in working. Now, a side I'll tell you about was sadly gone, but Steve Jordan's side, City of Winchester, who he started this club by putting a notice in his pub and saying, "You sit under this notice on the Wednesday evening, you know, join my Morris team." And he sat there, and a team turned up, but people had not done the Morris. They made democratic decisions on the costumes, so they bought football shirts and so on instead of the normal sort of Morris sort of kit thing like this. But they did Steve's interpretation of Ilmington very nicely, until they found themselves having to dance to a brass band. Now, the trouble with a brass band, whether it's the Salvation Army or the local regimental band, is that they play so many tunes, and you have to fit your Morris to what they can play. So he came up with a repertoire of dances with long figures, you know, eight by half figures, because the tunes the band would play were 16 bars long, and so on. But the effect was incredible because the brass band is so incredible. A large brass band produces a quality of sound you can wallow in, you know, and it's really superb to have the chance to dance to it. But it's a bit of an adaptation. Now, I say this because there are still people around who are a bit frightened of actually doing things for themselves. You know, there's an issue about self-esteem and things like this all rolled into it. But people have to be prepared, as it were, to do their own thing. Not to step outside the tradition. We didn't. We haven't done so today. But you've met a lot of, I hope, new material of things for people who care about how the tradition is used and are using it well. If you want to look at other fields like the Border Morris, there are 11 collected border dances, and you'd be hard pressed to see any because all the people who do border actually do better dances in the style, as it were, within the tradition. They have performance and style of dancing and so on, but they're not in the tradition in the sense they're based on actual traditional movements other than in the looser sweat sense. But it's still Border Morris, and it works, and we're grateful it exists. And simply what I've done with you today is Cotswold Morris, and I'm glad it exists in this sort of form. And that, I reckon, is time for me to stop, and I agreed to stop at 9:30.
I think it might be nice.
to the advanced Cotswold, I think they can cope with very similar to this,
but
going
twice as long.
Only twice as long. And you are allowed to go to sleep a bit. This is very similar to what the advanced Cotswold weekend ends up like.
But this time I promise you Irish Boris, Welsh Boris, and Isle of Man Boris, as well as English.
It's Wantage, just on the ridge road, just north of the
You can see Abingdon and Oxford and Bampton and Croydon.
It's always clear. Crazy.
Thank you.